Good morning. My name is Daniela Mantilla Sanchez. I'm going to present autism spectrum disorder. So, according to the DSM-5, the American Psychiatric Association defines autism, a spectrum disorder, as a complex developmental condition involving persistent challenges with social communication, restricted interest, and repetitive behavior. While the CIE-11 exposed that ASD is characterized by persistent deficits in the ability to initiate and to sustain reciprocal social interaction and social communication, and by a range of restricted, repetitive, inflexible patterns of behavior, interests, or activities that are clearly atypical or excessive for the individual's age and the sociocultural context. So, there is like the DSM-5 classify autism in severity levels. So there is like three levels. The first one, it's requires support. So it's the like it's characterized, but it's just like without support in place, deficits in social communication. Those are the most important things that we're going to clarify in autism. Those three things. So the verbal and nonverbal social, the communication skills, the social interactions. So we're going to classify it in three levels. So the first one, without support in place, deficits in social communication cause noticeable impairments. And the other is difficulty initiating social interactions and may appear to have decreased interest in social interactions. While in the restricted and repetitive behavior, we're going to classify that for that level, inflexibility of behavior causes significant interference with functioning in one or more contexts. Also, difficulty switching between activities and problems of organization and plan hamper independence. I'm going to show you a video that we're going to classify it, and you're going to tell me if, what level is it, okay? To be like more interactive. Now continue with level two. We're going to, it's the one that it's requires substantial support. So are the patients that, for example, have marked deficits in verbal and nonverbal social communication skills. Social impairments appeared even with supports in place. There are like limited social interactions and reduced responses to social overtures from others. And in the part of restricted repetitive behavior, we can see inflexibility of behavior, difficulty coping with change. Restricted and repetitive behaviors are frequently enough to be obvious to the casual observer and interfere with the functional in the variety of different contexts that I'm going to talk later. Distress and or difficulty changing the focus or actions. That's also really interesting because in the video we're going to focus on that thing exactly. And the last level is number three, that require very substantial support. So it's the one that it has severe deficits in verbal and nonverbal social communication skills, are limited, like really limited in social interactions and minimal response to social or overtures from others. Now, compared with the restricted and repetitive behavior to the others, level number three has an inflexibility of behavior, extremely difficult coping with change, restricted and repetitive behavior markedly interfere with functioning in all the spheres, and they have a great distress, difficulty changing focus on attention. So we're going to see the video. So it's the guy, he's playing with a notebook and he's really focused on that thing. Meanwhile, in the session, there are like people backwards telling him, hey, Sammy, like calling by his name, and he's focusing on his notebook. That's all. Look, the noise again. No interactions at all. just focus. And do you look that they are like stimulating? So with the note, he's focusing. Calling by his name. A lot of noises outside. No, he doesn't respond at all. It's really important, the noises back. Don't respond. He doesn't respond at all. Sure, movement. Steps. In the moment, we take off like the stimulation thing, the notebook. He focuses our attention. And then he hit himself with the tape. So that's really important how we can manage autism really different. Because if we take off that stimulation thing, he will get into this world. Meanwhile, he will be the notebook, with the notebook and doing some stereotypes things that are like really focused on those patients that have autism. So if you take those, that thing that it's distracting from that they're outside, he will come to this world. So it's really important how we have to manage the situation with autism. Sorry. Now, let's continue with the epidemiology. So in first instance, it is important to indicate that there are not enough studies for word autism. However, in the United States, there have been developed a few studies around the epidemiology of this condition. So according to the article that I base my information, Catherine Lord, it's one of the psychiatrists in Britain that it's, she's one of the most important psychiatrist specialized in autism. She said that she supposed that in 2020, there is a lot of prevalence in males over females. Also, a global burden of disease study says that 52 million people with autism globally, in a prevalence of that amount of people, one in 132 individuals has autism or born with autism. This study found little interpretable variation in the prevalence of autism between regions, disease, or cultural and socioeconomic factors. However, it was found that there is an increased prevalence of autism in Afro-Caribbean population. Okay, so about the etiology. The etiology, it's multifactorial, but in what sense? So is it mostly likely that we're talking about the genetic predisposition? Yeah, it's really important to base this situation. In fact, there are like several studies that corroborate it. They have talked more than anything about the polygenetic predisposition. That says that there are like several genes that are involved. Genetic predisposition comes like at the moment they appear, come a neurotoxic environmental stimulus that can be, for example, environmental contamination. Yeah, some exposure to some inappropriate chemicals. For example, there are regions that are like exposed to mercury, for example, to other neurotoxic, and makes it that when, for example, there is a place in Colombia or that there is a lot of people that work with pesticides for the roses, for plants. And we made a study that in that place, especially, it's a high prevalence of autism. So it's really important to know the environmental risk that autism has to be related, okay? What else? Yeah. So we have to know that also we must focus, okay, we already focused on the genetics, and it's really important, the genetic part. Also the environmental risk that it has to be related. Also, sorry if I am like extending a lot. There is a relation between gastrointestinal symptoms with autism. I made my investigation on that most of the girls, for example, what we eat, it's what we are. Yeah. So the mother, there is like a lot of theories about the autism. So we're going to focus in this part first, that it's environmental risk, what I told you. So the mother eats a lot of mercury, for example, in the fish, for example, big fishes that like salmon or other components that the fish had. And they start to eat. When the baby is born, for example, there is a high prevalence that they can have autism. My study based that when like autism, like people with autism, boys especially, they have a high prevalence of constipation compared to the neurotypical people. So we have to explain, if you want to, I can explain my thesis very clearly about the relation between gastrointestinal symptoms and autism. And if we manage this situation, they got all this constipation, all the dyspepsia that they have, they can manage their aggressivity or, for example, their crisis that they have, they can manage it just controlling what they eat. So it's really important, this relation. And it's not only with patients with autism, it's for us also, for neurotypical people. So that's a really important thing that if you want, I can extend more in that part. I love it. So I'm really happy if I can do it. Okay, what else? We have also a genetic predisposition that has been raised, and eventually stimulus toxic that generates an alteration in cerebral connectivity, that some of the specialties suggest that it may also be something related to the intestinal part, as already said. And for this reason, it's also associated that there are like boys and girls who have gastrointestinal symptoms, for example, constipation, dyspepsia, vomits, GERD, yeah. So there are some things that support that it's mine, that I'm, they already talked about that. And it apparently generates an alteration in the response of functional neurology. That's my part. So this is the part of the brain, connectivity. That's a huge new world that I really love to talk about that. So the connectivity, let's talk about that part. It's really important. Regarding this, there are like two theories. Or people with autism has infraconnectivity or hyperconnectivity. The cerebral hyperconnectivity is related to the fact that there are like too many neural networks, but it's a disorganized way, especially in the prefrontal headwork. Sometimes it says that they are very weak, that they are like very dense, but they're really weak. And that's this generation that this generates like an obstruction in the formation between the prefrontal area and the frontal area. There's also a theory of the hypoconnectivity or infraconnectivity, that it's when they shows that there is like a poor connectivity with a poor density in the connection between the prefrontal area and the frontal area. Yeah, it's related with a little neuronal flow, and also is related to dendritic growth. In other words, the information does not pass completely to the third functional block. This is the third functional block. So they got, for example, the stimulus, and they go to here and they project it to the frontal area. That's when there is like two problems, that there is a lot, like there is a traffic of neurons that they cannot get to the third block, that is to the frontal area, but they are like a lot of network, you know? So there's like two theories that if you want to, I can explain that too more deep. And so everything correlates with all the symptoms related to the processing speed, as well as that they have, for example, difficulty in face identification, they have impulsiveness, hyperactivity, with obvious attention deficit or inadequate focus attention. So that's what I want you to focus on this part also. Let's talk about the diagnostic criteria. So there, okay, I'm going to highlight one of the main changes that have been brought to the reformulation of the diagnostic criteria for autism comparing to like DSM-4 compared to the DSM-5. Yeah. So for example, in the first place, it is the DSM-4 criteria requires symptoms to be present in the first 3 years of life. But a criteria of this DSM-5, it says that we can recognize symptoms onset during the early developmental period. In a gradual, for example, on the gradual set, that we can identify in patients that are like less than 2 years of born, you know? So it's not, we have, for example, people or the carers or the parents, they can identify their child since they are like 2 years old. Not we have to wait until 4 and 5 years old, because with like waiting more time to identify autism, the brain, it's not like, you know, working. They're like stop in that area. So since if we identify autism in an early age, we can do a lot, and they can be not like regular, but they can have a better life, you know, compared with many time ago that they were just, okay, they have autism, let's put it there behind the bed, or you're not going to talk, you're not going to walk, you're going to be not useful for this world. No. So we already found out that we can do a lot with these guys, okay? Okay. Other two core elements of the diagnostic process and autism is that we have to focus or to be detailed in the developmental history and observation. Like we have to focus on how the child manage or how they interact with their parents, with other peers, with other people. So we can notice if they can look at their eyes, or they are just like this, or they start to walk into toys. That's one of the most important. Or they put a lot of things in lines. So if you see a guy or a child and take, for example, a puzzle, and you start to put it in lines, that's not normal. That's we have to, from doctors, or we can teach people that there, this is not normal. We have to focus on that and say, that's not good. We have to go to the neurologist or to the psychiatrist to study that part. Yeah. So there are a number of structured diagnostic interviews and observational assessments for autism, but I'm going to list only five of it. So there is the ADR, Autism Diagnostic Interview Review. There is also the ADOS 2. There is also the CARS 2. ASAS, that it's Australian scale for Asperger syndrome. That is not useful like a lot. And the last one, it's the NEA. NEA means a neuropsychological scale for autism spectrum. Okay, this is a new thing and it's in process, but I'm going to tell you about that. And it's a skill that we have to know, but we can identify with the girls, so with the boys, with autism, the three functional blocks, and we can identify how the brain dynamics. Yes. For example, at the functional anatomical level, through many execution of different works, like or different tasks. So, for example, we can doing, for example, the mirror neurons. They also focus on that part too. It's really important how, for example, you talk to the patient. So if you smile or do a little interactions with it, they can look at you and you can catch their attention. But if you're like talking really soft, you know, he's going to lost and he's going to keep focus on this. So that's where we have to talk really different to manage to, you know, a lot of sounds so they can catch our attention. And that's what the Nia do, does, for example. So jumping in frogs, or for example, please pick up this, please do this. So with a lot of tasks, we can know especially in which part of the brain is a problem. There is also a study that says in the third block, it's where, you know, the patient get into the first block to the second block really good, but when they have to execute the work, like, is diminished. Like, it doesn't go up again, like a neurotypical child or a person. There is a problem there in the execution of works. So that's where we have to focus on patients in that part, in the execution, okay? Okay, another thing is the co-occurring disorder. So ASD is really strongly associated with numerous coexisting conditions, physical, mental, neurodevelopmental, and functional. In addition, like the core features of autism, there are like co-occurring disorders, co-occurring difficulties, or disorders that are much more widely recognized in research. Also, they are not like necessarily adequate in the clinical practice. So, for example, for preschool children with autism, we can get, for example, language delays, motor problems, epilepsy, difficulty with sleeping, with eating, high levels of activity are most commonly observed in those patients. So comparing, for example, with ADHD, anxiety, obsessive compulsive disorders, intellectual disability, academic challenges, irritability, disruptive behaviors becomes more commonly, but in school age children, like with more age. Moreover, growing evidence suggests that people with autism have premature mortality and increased risk of self-harm. They also, they start to bite themselves or hit themselves or crash like their face with a lot of things. They're like that. So it's a possible suicide too. They have a high risk of suicide. Adults with autism compared, they're more likely to be diagnosed with many physical health conditions such as immune conditions, sleep disorders, obesity. Yeah, compared to the adults of the general population. So let's focus on the management. We're going to finish in a few minutes. So in this last topic, management, there is a, as I already told you, the early intervention is seen as a priority. So that's what we have to focus on, the early intervention to help that those patients to work very good or to work better in the future. So let's talk about medications. Well, those medications that have evidence of benefits for autism treatment that associate symptoms or co-occurring diagnosis rather than the symptom of autism directly. You know, so what in management here is that we treat epilepsy, we treat the ADHD, we treat other things than the autism, because with autism, we can't, yeah? So we're studying that. So medications, it's for the co-occurring disorders. Autism is an extremely heterogeneous disorder. An individual with autism can have a number of common co-occurring disorders that can also vary in severity. So there are like a lot of medications in this part, risperidone and aripiprazole, that they are like often teamed for atypical antipsychotics. They're approved in the USA to treat irritability, agitation, including aggression, self-injury, tantrums, in children and teenagers with autism. However, both treatments are associated with adverse effects, including sedation, risk of movement disorders, weight gain, you know? So limit like their use to people with severe irritability with agitation, you know? Other thing is the co-occurring mental health conditions are managed as follows. So for example, people with ADHD symptoms and autism, we're going to manage with methylphenidate, atomoxetine, and A1-vaccine. For people with depression, anxiety, and OCD, we can manage it with fluoxetine and citalopram. But in the general population, their efficacy is not being proved with people with those with anxiety, OCD, depression, with in autism. So it's not tested already with autism. What we have been showing, like, or seeing in many different articles, is that, for example, citalopram is demonstrated that there have poor tolerability and no benefit for repetitive behavior in children with autism. Yeah, so, and also fluoxetine, for example, improves symptoms of instead of diminish the symptoms, increase the symptoms of OCD. So in adults with autism, so that's really important to know. As I already told that, and I just want to let you know that, yeah, I already finished. I want to show you that this is a pathology that a lot of people, it's really scared of that. So it's already a lot of unknown things. It's missing a lot of studies. I'm prepared for all these studies, and I want to really, help a lot of people with autism, because we can help them perfectly, and we can help the family. That's the most important thing. So the patient is here. Surrounded is the family. That's the most important thing. Then is the school, then the society. We're in that process. So first of all, we have to manage family. Because with who are we going to talk? With their mom, with their dads, not with him, because the patient right now, he is in another world. So we have to catch mom's and dad's attention, first of all. So just to end this, if you want, I can also explain about how to manage a patient or how to organize and schedule with a patient with autism, because they are like in their brain, they manage with in an order. So for example, something that he's not used to that, or something strange, or they also have hypersensitivity, like in the earring card, or texture in their mouth. We can manage all those things, and we can understand them perfectly just seeing them, observing them. That's all. So just to end this presentation, discipline with love. So yes, that's all. Thanks for everything. I hope it's not complete. I want to talk about autism. But yes, just like a little thing, a little brush up in this pathology.